The MGM Theatre of the Air. Our star this week, Francho Tone. President of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, a noted writer of many Broadway and Hollywood musical hits, Mr. Howard Beach.
Thank you. We have a broad expanse of drama this week, ranging from the loose little island of Manhattan to the intertwined jungles of South America. The MGM Theater of the Air presents a tale of treachery and adventure. His brother's wife. Our star is the popular Francho Tone, who portrays on our radio stage the role of Dr. Chris Claiborne. Adventure begins in just a moment. His Brother's Wife, starring Francho Tone on the MGM Theater of the Air. Gamblers will bet on almost anything, provided they have an edge. But even the most confirmed gambler would have hesitated to name odds on the chances of Chris Claiborne linking with Rita Wilson. Different backgrounds, different codes, different worlds, these two. And still they met. It happened in the gambling room of Buck Davis's Crystal Inn on a night when Chris Claiborne had been losing and Rita Wilson winning at roulette.
And it's red. $225 to Mr. Ellison.
Mr. Davis?
Yes.
Claiborne's into us for $5,000.
All right, man.
20 on 8.
5 on 8.
All down. And here's the winner. And it's 8. And it's black.
Oh, good.
$175 to Miss Wilson. 2 yellow splits.
Oh, Dr. Claiborne.
Nice timing, Davis.
How's that, Doctor?
I intercepted your signal to the croupier. No more credit to Claiborne.
I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right. It was nice timing, though. My number came up. You saved yourself a lot of money.
Well, Doctor, you're into us for $5,000.
Yeah, I know. I'll give you a little check.
Suppose we step in here.
Said the spider to the fly.
How's that, Doctor?
Never mind. Skip it. Oh, hello, Mike.
Hi, you sucker.
One thing about Mike. Wonderful sense of humor. Well, Davis, let's settle this $5,000 debt of mine.
Let's, Doctor.
I haven't got $5,000 to begin with.
Well, that complicates our settlement, doesn't it, Doctor?
Well, not necessarily. I'm good for it.
Fine, fine. Then if you'll write out this blank check.
I'll need time, Davis. I'm good, but I'll need time.
Dr. Claiborne, in 2 weeks you're leaving this town for the jungle.
You get your news fast.
It's my business to know everything about my customers, Doctor. For instance, I know you're not a good risk once you leave. No insurance company give a nickel on your chances of ever coming back.
What you're saying is you want my check before I go.
That's partly right.
You'll get it.
Doctor, I want your check right now. Tonight.
Tonight? See, sucker?
Even if it isn't worth the paper it's written on?
I'll worry about that.
Well, I don't get it, but okay. You got a pen?
The way I look at these things, business is business.
Here you are.
Thank you, Doctor. Mike, you're a witness to this.
Right, Mr. Davis.
Wait a minute. He's a witness to what?
Why, that I cashed your check for $5,000, Doctor.
Cashed it?
That's right.
Cashed it, sucker.
So if anything's wrong with it, Doctor, your address will be the penitentiary for 10 years.
Why, you dirty...
Easy. A precautionary measure, don't they call it? My own brand of preventive medicine.
How long do I get?
You sail in 2 weeks, the 14th. To get to the 13th. I treat my customers right. Or I try to.
Oh, Dr. Claiborne.
Yeah? Oh, hello.
I heard Davis call you that. You are Dr. Claiborne.
Yeah, one of them. My father's another, and also my brother.
I followed your bet on 8 last and selected.
Well, good for you. Say, shouldn't that be celebrated? I've got enough left to buy you a drink. One.
I came up to buy you one, Doctor. I noticed you didn't collect.
Hey, I ought to call you Miss Eagle Eye, but I'd rather know your real name.
Rita Wilson.
That's one bet I'd won tonight anyway.
Okay.
Strictly personal. I bet myself I'd know your name before I left here.
Oh.
I've been watching you, see, Miss Wilson?
Diagnosing, Doctor?
Admiring, beautiful. Oh. And my name's Chris. My friends call me Chris. If you like, you can be different and call me Chris. Oh. Let's get that drink.
Wait, I have a better idea.
Well, right now, for me, a drink's the best idea there could be.
On the other side of those double doors, there's an orchestra. People don't drink.
I was wrong. There is a better idea. Drink and dance. And while we're thusly engaged, you can inform me about yourself. Who you are, how you got so beautiful, what time you changed back into a pumpkin. Holy smoke.
What's the matter?
It's after midnight.
Oh, do Doctors Claiborne, father and brother, keep a light burning for you?
Well, I've almost missed an appointment. Maybe I have missed it, or maybe they're still there. Look, beautiful, give me your phone number. I'll call you.
You'll find me around here, Doctor. I spend my happiest hours in this place.
Okay. I'm sorry. It's important.
She must be to be forgotten in so many hours.
Hey, wait a minute. Sure.
You doctors always rush back and forth so jittery. I thought expectant fathers had a corner on that.
Beautiful, you're coming with me.
I am not.
Don't argue. All of a sudden, I couldn't leave. I don't know why. It's never happened before.
Now, look, you...
But something went zing, and I'm going to find out what it was. We're going to find out together. Come on. Well, the lab's empty. They're gone.
Is this where you work? Surrounded by all these bottles and test tubes? Oh,
he won't hurt you. Just a guinea pig and sick.
Sick?
Yeah, it's nothing important. This one down here is the baby that ought to be sick, and isn't.
Oh. Well, that means what? If it's not top secret.
Well, he's been injected with what we hoped was spotted fever germs. He's well, so the serum didn't have the germs, so the ticks we thought carried spotted fever don't carry it, so the thing's still as big a mystery as ever, and we start all over again.
Oh, you keep saying we. Who are we?
Chris.
Yes, Gus. Here comes the rest of we, the really important half.
I heard voices. I was in my office. I have a young lady. I didn't know.
Miss Wilson, Dr. Fahrenheim, one of the great men of medicine.
How do you do, Doctor?
Well, I would do better if my assistant kept appointment. Chris, we waited for you.
I'm sorry, Gus.
Sorry.
Does the expedition get the financing?
Well, I am no salesman, Chris. I don't talk so good, but...
But?
We get the money, yes.
Oh, Gussie, you're wonderful. Isn't he wonderful, beautiful?
I wouldn't be surprised.
That boy.
But on second thought, it was a pushover for you.
There, you see, 1 minute hot, 1 minute cold.
Well, Wilson's outfit has lost 9,000 workers in that jungle from spotted fever. It's good business for them to finance an expedition to find a cure.
If I'm not out of line asking, what is all this about spotted fever in the jungle and an expedition?
Wait. Chris has not told you.
I've been too busy telling her she's something special in my life, Gus. Look at her. You blame me?
Is he always like this, Dr. Fahrenheit?
He is when he's with you. Come on, we've got places to go and things to do.
But, Chris, we must talk, you and I. There are matters we must talk about.
Another time, Gus. First things first. And right now, Miss Wilson comes ahead of the guinea pigs. And that, beautiful, from a scientist, is a compliment. Favorite spot of mine. The lights of the city spread out like a carpet under your front wheels.
I've never been up here before.
No one has. Only people I like a whole lot.
You know, one thing you said interested me, Chris.
Only one thing?
No. I mean about there being no room for love in your life.
Well, that's true enough.
Just fun and work.
Well, fun mostly. My father and brother do most of the work for the family.
The reason I'm interested, I don't want love any more than you do.
Oh?
So we'll get along swell, won't we?
Yeah. Yeah, strictly for fun.
And laugh.
And laugh.
Where are we going? We just got here.
Well, I forgot. It's not such a good spot for laughs. But I know plenty of places that are. Music, fun, people, and lots of laughs. Let's go find her to help us. Remember this place, Rita?
Oh, yeah.
We came here that first night.
I know.
Same table. The officers playing the same piece. I requested it.
We'll dance in the same corner.
Fred.
What?
You're getting sentimental.
Well, sure I am.
Why not? Sentiment's entirely... Oh,
I see what you mean.
It's dangerous, Fred.
Yeah, it is.
I'm a wee bit sentimental, Mike.
Then let's get out of this place fast. Another cup of coffee for two, miss. We're quiet tonight, beautiful.
I was thinking it's just 5 days before you go.
No, 20 hours. Sounds longer, say it that way. You gonna miss me, Rita?
You've managed to cloud the past week for me.
You know, you never did tell me about yourself. We talked about everything under the sun except you.
I'll tell you sometime. It's a dull story.
Well, then don't tell me. 5 days left, not a dull minute, Rita. Promise?
Promise, Chris.
Lots of sparkle.
And no dullness. And in case you don't know it, mister, that happens to be my specialty.
Well, here's a bench. I'm tired of walking.
It's a big park. Oh, I'm tired, too. So, you were saying...
I've got 10 hours left before my boat sails.
No, not that.
Oh, yeah, about my professional aspirations. Mm. They aren't much, I'm afraid. I never took them or myself too seriously. I leave all that to Dad and Tom.
Tom's your brother?
He's a wonderful guy, Rita. You'll love him.
Will I?
And with that note on the character of Chris Claiborne, we exhaust the subject and turn to one Rita Wilson.
Well, give me a cigarette, will you?
Yeah. It's your brand.
Thanks. Yeah. 24, unattached. I was in love once. It was a mistake. Getting over it, I managed to scuttle a flock of silly notions about life and men and happiness.
Just a hardened old cynic.
Say, just distressful.
Of life and men and happiness?
Of being vulnerable.
Build a wall around yourself and you get nowhere.
Build a wall around yourself and you don't get hit. But it's got to be a high wall.
Or somebody might climb over it. Maybe somebody has. Is that it?
Oh, Chris.
Sweet.
I didn't want it to happen.
I know.
And when it did, when I realized, I tried so hard not to show it.
Because you didn't want to be vulnerable?
Because you said strictly for fun and laughs.
Rita, look at me.
Yes, Chris.
I love you, Rita. I'm mixed up. This wasn't the ending we expected, but I'm not mixed up about that. I do love you.
Darling. Oh, darling.
Come on. I'm taking you home.
Home?
To meet Tom and Dad. It's time they started getting acquainted with the future Mrs. Chris Claiborne.
Dad's operating. It's an emergency. Too bad he isn't here for this great occasion. I'll have to fill in for him.
Tom, what's the matter?
Matter?
Well, the minute I brought Rita in here, you froze up.
Oh, it's no reflection on Miss Wilson, I assure you. Call it... Well, call it the circumstance.
Well, what circumstance?
Just a minute, Chris. Dr. Claiborne, I want to say one thing.
Yes, Miss Wilson?
When Chris introduced us, you took in my mink coat, this diamond bracelet, and my hat.
A Marianne original, isn't it?
You think that anyone who dresses this way isn't the right wife for a young doctor starting his career. You're right. But I don't measure happiness in terms of mink coats and diamond bracelets. I did once. But all I care about now is helping Chris, working with him and for him.
Miss Wilson, you assume I question the richness of your attire. On the contrary, I admire it.
From the way you look.
I admire it. For a young doctor, a wife wealthy enough to afford these luxuries is a great asset. But you, Miss Wilson, are not wealthy.
No.
And I should tell you that your background is not unknown to me.
My background?
What exactly does that mean?
A man named Davis phoned me this morning, Chris. He holds a check of yours for $5,000.
Well, what's that got to do with it?
He wants his money before you sail in the morning.
Hey, what is this? I saw Davis today. I gave him all I could raise.
$2,500.
He agreed to wait for the rest, extend my credit. Then he calls you. What is this, anyhow?
I'm told that you can go to prison unless that check is covered.
Well, that's right, but Davis agreed...
Mr. Davis has changed his mind, Chris.
Well, I can't raise $2,500 in 10 hours.
I'll cover the balance. Relax. Miss Wilson, you work for this gambler, David.
I used to.
He is under the impression you still do. This sounds mid-Victorian, doesn't it? He warned me against you.
Wait a minute, Tom.
Let me finish, Chris. He said Miss Wilson is after the Claiborne money. He said that money is her keystone in life. He said that he can prove that her work for him consists of bringing her gentleman friends to Davis's establishment. Steering them there was his expression.
Rita, is that true?
Would it matter terribly if it was?
I'm asking you.
I'm asking you, Chris.
No, but that's a dirty business.
Cheap.
Then it does matter.
Miss Wilson, I don't want Chris to marry you. And I don't think he wants to, really.
You don't deny that brotherly statement, Chris.
Well, I'm waiting for you to deny what Davis said about you.
This coat and bracelet didn't come from him, I'll tell you that much.
From whom, then? One of those gentleman friends? Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean
that. Chris, listen to me. You know how Dad has counted on your going on this expedition. Working with a man like Fahrenheim, he sees it as your great opportunity.
But I'll go, Tom. I'll go.
I said I'll cover the balance on that check. Well, there's a condition. There are two conditions. You sail with Fahrenheim in the morning, and you give up the idea of marriage until you come back. What do you say, boy?
Tom, I don't know.
Well, I do.
Rita, listen.
You listen. I'm sorry I ever walked into the life of this precious family. I'm sorry I was staff enough to listen to a playboy's line of happy talk. But I can still walk away grinning, and I'm doing it.
Hey, wait a minute, Rita.
I leave you boys with just one thought. If you're ever going under for the third time, call me. I'll be happy to hold you down for the count. I'll be delighted to do that for you both.
Chris.
Yeah?
You're well out of it, you know that.
I'm not sure whether I'm coming or going.
You're going, boy. Upstairs to pack to make that boat in the morning. Next stop, the South American jungle.
Already 6-7 times I have told you a letter came this afternoon.
Okay, Gus.
Oh, Chris, it is no use anymore fooling with that serum.
I thought I was out of something here. Why, something that won't work. It never works. 3 months in this oven. Days full of crawling bugs and nights full of screaming cheetahs, and we're nowhere. Nowhere, Gus.
Read your letter, Chris. It's from your brother, I think.
You read it. I'm not interested.
But it's news from home, Chris. Ah, look, you must see it so. With every failure, we get closer to success, yeah? Sometime we come out of the darkness. It is light. It is success.
You may live to see it, Gus. I won't. All right. Give me the letter.
We stumble, we, how you say, grope like blind men.
Yeah, this is from Tom.
And all the while we eliminate. Yeah, elimination process, Chris. It's not one thing, so...
Gus.
What? What is it, Chris?
It can't be. She wouldn't... She couldn't.
My boy, what is it? You are gray like death.
They're married. Tom and Rita.
Rita? The girl you... Oh, no, it is some mistake.
Listen to this. Rita and I were married on the 23rd.
What? 2 weeks ago, the 23rd.
I don't expect you to understand, but I pray you can forgive. Gus, I'm going back.
No, it is too late.
This isn't my brother, not the brother I know. Look at the handwriting, shaky, thin, something impossible. Terrible has happened, and I've got to find out what it is.
Loyalty of brother for brother is a strong bond, but is it strong enough to survive the intrusion of a woman like Rita Wilson? We'll return in a moment to discover what really happened. 2 of His Brother's Wife, starring Franco Tone with Alice Frost. Dr. Chris Claiborne, at work with a research expedition in the jungle, received a letter from his brother Tom with news of Tom's marriage. It should have been good news, excepting that the girl Tom married is Rita Wilson. Rita, who had loved Chris, wanted to marry Chris, but had been prevented by Tom from doing it. Rita, who hated Tom and with good reason now married to Tom. Why? To find the answer to that question, Chris returns to New York, faces his brother now in the grand office overlooking Park Avenue.
And since when do you keep liquor in your desk drawer?
A good idea, this Chrissy boy. Here, your glass.
No, thanks.
My glass now.
And what's Dad think of this? You, the way you are.
What's the matter with the way I am?
Well, you're drunk, for one thing. Thin as a rail. Close to being a nervous wreck.
Nonsense, Chrissy boy.
Well, what's Dad say?
Dad say? What does Dad say? He said plenty. I haven't seen him lately.
Tom, what's that all about? I got your letter. I couldn't believe
it. You can believe it, all right.
But Rita.
Rita.
Why, Tom? Why?
Perfectly simple. I love her.
You don't?
I don't, he says. I don't. I don't. Maybe I don't if I... Maybe that's why I can't work anymore. I can't either sleep or think, and a face doesn't swim before my eyes, taunting me, laughing, beckoning me.
Cut it out.
Sorry, Chrissy boy. Another drink.
And what about Mary, Tom?
She returned my ring, of course.
You and Mary have been in love for years.
Yeah.
She always planned to get married. She built her life around you. She's right for you, Tom, not Rita.
But I'm married to Rita, Chief.
I want to know how it happened.
I want to know how you do, huh? Well, I want to see her. Guilty conscience. I got to thinking. I decided I'd been rough on her to send you away like I did, so I went to see her.
Yeah?
She was sweet, forgiving, very sweet, gentle.
Yeah?
I'd never known anyone like Rita. Chris, something new, out of my line entirely, but wonderful. The world is a different place when you see it through her eyes.
I know.
I fell in love with her. I asked her to marry me.
Does she love you, Tom? Tom, cut it out!
I asked her, does she love you? Does she love you? Does she love you? We eloped, Chrissy boy, to Greenwich. We routed out a minute. And coming back in the cab, she started to laugh.
What?
Laugh. You know what that is, laughing. Ha, ha, ha. When we hit New York, she got out of the cab. She said, thanks for the ride. And I haven't seen her since.
So that's what it is.
She won't talk to me. She won't see me. She doesn't answer my letters.
Revenge. The sort of revenge jungle cat would think of. Torture. Hurting.
Another drink, Chrissy boy. You say I don't love her. Maybe I don't. Maybe I hate her. But I can't forget her. She's my wife. Don't you forget it. I don't forget it.
Goodbye, Tom.
You going already? Where are you going?
Out. On business. Ease up on that drink, see you?
Sure.
You're liable to spoil your sense of humor. And you're going to need a good sense of humor, Tom. Mighty soon.
Well, well, well. Young Dr. Claiborne.
Oh, hello, David.
Looking for Rita Wilson.
Rita Wilson Claiborne, isn't it? I heard she was married.
Are you here, David?
I think my customer's right, or try to, Claiborne. Aim to please, if you know what I mean. He's playing at the third table down.
Thanks.
And here's the winner. And it's 14, and it's red.
Hello, Rita.
Benny, be a good boy and get in. For a minute, I thought you... Davis must be serving bum liquor. I'm having hallucinations.
No, I'm afraid not.
Chris.
Prettier than Benny, don't you think? Your name, I mean.
It is you.
I know you're surprised, but are you glad to see me?
My dear doctor, you know you never met a girl who wasn't. But I really must find Benny. He could have gone.
Cast yourself in, Rita. I want to talk to you.
Darling, another time. I'm on a winning streak.
Not another time, now.
I'm sorry, darling.
Rita. Rita, I came 6,000 miles to see you.
I'll bet.
For nothing else in the world.
You know something, Doctor? That playboy line of happy talk didn't get a bit rusty down in that jungle. You're still persuasive. Well,
come on, man.
I can get away in an hour, no sooner.
I'll pick you up.
Wait. That's straight. About coming back to New York to see me.
That's straight.
Why, Chris? 6,000 miles is a long way to travel to see a girl.
I heard about you and Tom.
You could have mailed congratulations.
I'm not congratulating you.
What then?
Well, if I tell you now, we won't have anything to talk about in an hour.
And that would be awful, wouldn't it? You and I with nothing to talk about. All right, darling. I'll save up my questions.
For an hour, beautiful, and then ask them all. I'll have the answers. Mary, this is Chris, Mary. I'm up on a quick trip going back right away. Look, I saw Tom this afternoon. Mary, he's going to need you desperately. I haven't time to explain, but what's happened is like a disease for him. He's sick, Mary, and when he starts getting well, it'll be you he'll turn to. Well, I want to know one thing. Will you be there when he does? No, not if he does, when he does. I'm that sure. Will you be there? Thanks, Mary. For Tom and for me, thanks.
Spread out like a carpet under your front wheel.
Same place, same light, same girl.
I came up here once alone. It wasn't the same without you.
It wouldn't be.
Well, where was I? Oh, yes. So when he asked me, I married him, that's all. I never pretended to love him. I suppose I did it to get even.
I figured something like that.
I've been hurt before, plenty. But never like he did. Like you did between you. I wanted to hurt back.
You did?
I know. I wanted to get even with you too, Chris.
I suppose so.
That's the difference. When you love someone, you can't deliberately hurt him no matter what. You were an awful fool, though.
Was I, really?
An awful fool. To let a mink coat and a diamond bracelet throw you.
Yeah, pretty childish that was.
Remember I said I thought I was in love once, and it was a mistake?
Yeah?
I married him. The biggest part of the mistake. The coat and bracelet are all I've got to show for it. And I've never worked for Buck Davis. I never steered any gentleman friends to his joints. That was a lie.
But you weren't going to cheapen yourself by denying it, huh?
Oh, if you'd believe that about me, I... How do people get themselves so mixed up, Chris?
Well, they fall in love, and out goes judgment, good sense, logic. Rita.
Yes?
What do you plan to do about him?
I don't know, Chris. Divorce him, I suppose.
Well, it's not easy.
Or let him divorce me.
Not easy either.
I don't know what to do. I tried to avoid thinking about it.
You haven't seen Tom lately?
No.
He's pretty broken up.
So am I. I've got to live with myself, Chris. I'm not sailing through this thing on a clear sea, remember?
You might sail out of it, though.
I might what?
There's a fruit boat leaving at 6 in the morning. I'm going to be on it. Will you join me?
Wait. No, wait a minute.
Well, it's a way out. Maybe the only way.
I said, wait. How exactly do we stand? You and I.
As long as you're my brother's wife, I won't touch you. Even to shake hands.
But when I'm not?
I came 6,000 miles to get you, Rita.
And I can make of that whatever I please. I love you, Chris. That's obvious. And you loved me once. Now I don't know. I can't tell. And you won't say, of course. As long as I'm your brother's wife. You did come 6,000 miles to get me.
I did do that.
All right, Chris. It's a good enough gamble. 6 a.m., a fruit boat. I'll be on it with you.
Okay, Oscar. Tip your hat to the nice lady who gives you the toast.
See, he's a wonderful monkey.
He likes you too, Miss Rita. And that toast you feed him every morning.
Come on. Come on up here, Oscar. See what I have for you. If you like me so much, I do think you might have brought a letter for me, Oscar.
2 months. Every day you look for that letter, but it never comes. I'm sorry, Miss Rita.
It's hard to be patient sometimes, Chief, that's all. Are the doctors ready for their lunch yet?
Now, I'll tell you one thing, ma'am. I'm only a handyman around this camp. I do what I'm told, same as I'm doing for Dr. Fahrenheim for 22 years. I got no business criticizing. But those two don't take proper care of themselves, Miss Rita. Day and night, night and day, work, 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 trying to save these natives' lives. They'll kill themselves.
What do you think we can do about it, Pete?
Well,
you
stop worrying and feed us when we're hungry.
Sometimes Chris gets good ideas. That is one.
Lunch has been ready and waiting for almost an hour.
Good, good. Oh, Pete, here. Yeah. There is a thing I want you to do over here.
You're getting used to serving meals under canvas, Rita?
If you're used to eating them.
You're full of surprises, you know. Imagine, Rita, a good cook.
Cooking, I don't mind. The tent I can stand, but this native city.
Yeah, it looks like something that fell off the back end of a truck, doesn't it? Now, after a while, you forget to notice.
I could hear you slamming around the laboratory most of the night. Sit down, drink your coffee.
You know, beautiful...
Don't call me that. Anyhow, not here. Not when we're at arm's length from each other forever, oh God.
You're not having much fun, are you?
All I know is I'm in the same place you are. I'm unhappy and happy all at the same time. I wish you'd take better care of yourself.
I want to take care of something called spotted fever. And I'm getting nowhere doing
it. Dr. Fairnon says you're making progress.
I'm just a believer in the process of elimination. I guess I don't have the patience for it. No mail yet, huh?
Not today.
Not today, not yesterday, or last week, or last month. Why don't we hear something? How long is he going to wait?
Will you eat the food while it's hot?
I've had a crazy notion the last few days, Rita. What if Tom hates me so much for taking you away, he won't bother with a divorce?
Don't say that.
He does hate me, you know. He must. He was crazy in love with you.
He'll go through with it, Chris.
We don't know that.
He will. He's got to. We must keep thinking that, knowing that he will go through with it. Oh!
You jump at that, huh, Lisa?
Oh, I'll never get used to it. What did Chris say it was? A cheetah?
Yeah. Always they get noisy at night. Hungry.
They make Oscar nervous. It's all right, little fella. He's worried about Pete, too. Ever can be keeping him so long.
Well, it's a long journey to the mail boat. He will be here soon.
You hear that, Oscar? Chris still working, Dr. Stanley?
Yeah, he works. He will not stop work, that boy. Rita, why?
Why does he work?
Why does he act so to you? He brings you here, I think, to marry you and have a honeymoon. And it's a fine thing for Chris. You love him. You are a good cook. What more does he want?
It's a long story, Dr. Fahrenheim.
Please. To a friend, I am God. You are a friend. Oh, Oscar says that Pete is coming.
Oh.
You see?
I tried to make it back sooner, but those roads are impossible. Yes, we do look.
Oh, it came.
Something came. It's been a scorcher, hasn't it, Doc?
No, not so hot today.
I feel it for some reason. Hi, Oscar, baby. Do you see what Petey brought for you?
Pete, you are tricking.
I told you, I'm roasting. Been burning up the road, I guess.
Any hot coffee handy for a tired slave?
Yeah, there is a party. Pete, you come with me. I fixed you something to cool you down.
You're mighty engrossed, young lady. What you got there? The latest bestseller of... What's that, a letter?
The letter, Chris. Read it.
Well.
Oh, darling. At last. At last.
So he's finally free of you.
We've waited so long, Chris.
Yeah, we have.
It's almost like a dream. I can't believe it. We wanted it so much.
And now we've got it.
Yes. Now we... Chris, what's the matter?
Matter? Nothing. Everything's fine.
You look so strange all of a sudden.
I've waited a long time to give you this beautiful...
What? Envelope.
Open it. Go ahead. Your passage to New York, one way. And all the spare money I've got.
Oh, what does it mean?
It means you scram, baby. You're through as far as the Claiborne tribe's concerned. Through.
Oh,
you
no.
get it?
No, Chris, wait.
I'm through waiting. You're the only girl in the world I ever wanted to even the score with, and I'm doing it. Our account's balanced, paid in full. And you're clearing out of here and out of my life right now.
An unexpected shock to Rita, an unexpected turn to our story. Presently, we'll see where it leads us. MGM Theatre of the Air presentation, His Brother's Wife, starring Franco Tone with Alice Frost. Chris Claiborne's position was delicate. He loved his brother Tom. He had once loved Tom's wife, Rita. He knew Rita married Tom for revenge. And he saw that the marriage was ruining Tom's career, destroying his happiness. Chris acted. He took Rita away with him, southward to the jungle camp, where Chris and Dr. Farenheim are searching for a cure for spotted fever. There he waited for word of Tom's divorce action to reach him. When it finally came, Rita's reaction is joy and relief.
Oh, darling, at last. I can't believe it. It's like a dream. We've wanted it so much.
But Chris's reaction is something quite different, quite startling.
Here's your passage to New York, one way. You're clearing out of here and out of my life right now.
Now it is that evening. Rita's boat will not sail for 2 days. In one of the crude tents of the jungle camp, a man lies stricken with the dreaded fever. Pete, the handyman. Sinking so rapidly, it is a blow to the two doctors standing helplessly beside his cot.
Pulse rapid, Freddy. Hemorrhages in the skin. Ecchymosis is present.
Petey, try to tell us. Did you drink water not boiled?
No. No water. Ticks.
Ticks again.
Always it is ticks. But what kind?
Typhus is spread by lice, malaria by mosquitoes, sleeping sickness by the treats we fly. Spotted fever by what? In the name of heaven, by what?
Chris, it's awful late. You and Gus have got to get some rest.
I thought I told you
to... I can't go till there's a boat to go on. And that's the day after tomorrow.
Here, Pete, my boy, drink. So. Yeah, good, good.
I can help while I'm waiting. I'll nurse Pete. Please, I'll sit with him while you two sleep.
We'll manage without you.
Chris. Pete was my friend, too.
Stop saying words. He's not dead yet. No. Do not shout, Chris.
Rita, you want to help?
May I go, please?
She's no nurse. She won't know what to do.
There is nothing to do, Chris, and you know it. Let her stay. You come with me.
I'll call you if there's any change at all.
Petey. Of all people, Petey. Gus, we just can't stand by and let him die.
God has not shown us how to prevent it. We have not shown ourselves. This is not easy for me either, Chris.
But he was all right this morning. This afternoon, when he left for the mail, we were kidding together. He sat with me, had his glass of goat's milk while I had my coffee, the same as any other day. And tonight...
Yeah, I know, Chris. 22 years Pete has worked with me.
Wait a minute, Gus.
Yeah? What now?
Goat's milk.
Well, if you like some, we will get some.
No, no, Gus. I got an idea. One shot in a million, in the dark at that.
What is it, Chris? Miss, I know.
Well, we've been getting ticks off plants and trees and vines and out of water, but there are ticks that feed on animal's blood.
And if the animal is infected...
Those ticks could be the carriers of spotted fever. It's possible, Gus. Come on, let's see if it's a fact.
Hey, pull his head around a little further. I better get into that vein.
Yeah, this is better.
Hey, what's that jar of ticks we took off his hide? Don't take it over.
Yeah. The lantern is enough light to use the hypodermic needle.
Yeah, plenty. Steady now. We'll have what we need.
So, the guinea pig escaped with the metal cap, and the cap is a tick. How do you come to the serum, Chris?
Well, Gus, keep your eye on that tick.
Yeah, yeah. Lisa has not called us.
That means so far so good for Pete.
That means so far no better, I'm afraid. Oh, Himmel, how fast he sinks. I am watching, and suddenly... Chris!
I'm almost finished.
The pig, he has keeled over.
They play possum sometimes, you sure?
A foolish question. The pig is sick with a spotted fever.
And we've isolated the tick, Gus. But the goat wasn't sick, so we must have developed an immunity.
And his blood is the source of our serum. You have it ready?
Yes. Now, inject. Sit tight. See what happens.
Yes, I didn't expect that.
How is it?
No change. What's that?
Serum, Rita. We have found the answer.
Well, if we save Pete, that'll be the answer.
Oh, then hurry.
Oh, I do not like his eyes, Chris. It is not good. More blankets, please, Rita.
I'm ready here. Swing that lantern over this way.
So.
Good. There. Now we wait and pray.
You can't just sit there.
He rallied to the serum, Chris. We saw it. But he was too far gone.
We failed again.
No, no, we did not.
Come on, Chris. Be light.
So we bury Pete on the hillside, and tomorrow we find a new human guinea pig.
We did not fail. Pete did not die for nothing. You have found something. The serum will work.
Beyond guinea pigs, but on men. Maybe if I hadn't given it to Pete, he'd still be alive.
Chris, stop torturing yourself.
He might still be alive.
It will work if it is given time. I know it. You must not give up, Chris. You are on the right track. You have the answer in your hand.
Chris.
And who's that?
Dr. Capolo. You remember Chris, the native official.
Health director of the province. Such title. What's he want?
Senor Dodrick, good morning.
Something we can do for you, Doctor?
I'm sorry. No. Senors, I bring you news. By order of the governor, your permit to practice in the province or enter the interior is revoked.
Oh, no.
Revoked?
What is this? What do you do to us?
Senors, you have been here months. Our people still die. You have found no serum.
But we have. We believe
you
that...
You believe. Senor Doctor, you have believed before.
Yes, but this time...
There will be no this time. Senor Doctor, permit me to make all clear. Some of our people survive this fever even without your help. Your work here excites fear, what you call symptoms. Our people are afraid, senor. The feeling is bad. The governor has decided. It is forbidden that you continue. Good morning, senor. And senorita.
And so, amen.
Again, science fights superstition and fear.
Yes. I'm sorry.
Forget it. You'll be able to clear out of this rat hole. Get back to civilization. Into a clean shirt again.
You are quitting, Chris?
I've been fired. Didn't you get it? So have you.
If we try out that serum on any citizen down here, anyone, they'll jug us. You heard Coppola.
Not anyone, Chris.
What?
You can't experiment with nature. But you can do what you darn pleases me. I've got faith in your friend.
No, no, no.
Oh, relax, Gus.
Chris, you need a human guinea pig, and I'm applying for the job. What do you say?
I say it's a nice grandstand play for your eggs.
Chris, I mean it.
Sure you do. You know what the odds are. You can just see Gus and me infecting you, infecting any woman with a deadly disease for a risky experiment.
Oh, Chris, you...
But it was a good try, baby. Sounded wonderful.
No, Chris, she meant it.
See, you even convinced Gus here.
Ah, you are more stupid than Coppola and the governor together. Lisa, don't notice him. I understand. I thank you, Lisa.
Forget it, Gus. I've been right once in my life. When I agreed with young Dr. Claiborne that this place fell off the back end of a truck. A garbage truck. I'm getting out. Fast.
Ah, love. It puzzles me more than style. I don't know what to make of you, Chris.
I'll tell you that. I don't know what to make of myself, Chris. But right now I'm getting some sleep. Then we'll decide where we go from here.
Come make the pop-up, baby.
Hey, there it is. Let's settle this, Gus.
No. No, it is not right.
Will you stop crabbing? It's my party.
No, but you are young, Chris. I am old. It is not fair.
You're beginning to think you haven't any faith in my serum. I'll get everything set.
Cut store. The Curry, Morton. Yeah, remember them, old man. Remember and have a little faith.
Hello, Gus.
Oh, hello, Rita.
I stopped in to say goodbye. My boat sails tonight.
So. Oh, you and the boy, Rita. It's too bad. I'm sorry.
So am I, Gus. What is? If.
You love him very much.
I shouldn't. Can't seem to talk myself out of it.
Then you should know.
I should know what?
He is going to be the guinea pig.
He's going to be... But he can't be. You mustn't let him.
He cast the dice. It is decided, Rita.
But you don't know how that stuff's going to work. This is crazy.
Yeah. But if you love crazy people, you have to be crazy, too.
It's my fault.
What? What do you say, Rita?
The way he is. It's my fault. I won't let him do it, you understand? I won't let him.
No, Rita, please. Nobody lets Chris or don't let him.
Gus, what are his chances?
Good. I think good.
How are you going to do it?
Well, it is very simple. This needle is full of germs, see? We inject, we infect him, and then with the serum, please God, we save him.
Death in one hand, uncertainty in the other. Is that it?
I think it will be all right, Rita. But I am glad you have come. Maybe you can change his mind. If not, then he will be very sick and you must stay.
Oh, yes.
I will leave you, Rita.
He'll try to kick me out, but you won't let him, will you, Gus?
We will talk to him now. He's in the compound.
Yes, I'll wait for you here.
Yeah.
You call him, will you?
Yes. It's good. Chris, someone is here. Yeah, we will talk to him. Maybe he will listen. He's coming, Lisa. He will not send you back now.
No, I don't think he can now.
No. Look, you tell him what that I have said, what he plans to do, and you are worried. He will laugh at that, but do not listen to him.
Well. Oh, you do turn up, don't you? I thought your boat was loading.
I just dropped by to say it fast so long.
I told her what we do, Chris. She worried about you.
I'll bet. What are you shivering for?
Jitters, I guess. But, Gus, can you get me something to quiet me down, please?
Yeah. You must not be tired before you start out. I will get you something.
I'd suggest you lie down and rest, but there's only one bunk room here.
And welcome rubbed off the mat, anyhow.
Himmel!
What's the matter?
Rita, did you touch this hypodermic? What did you do with it, Rita?
What hypodermic?
Did you get something to quiet me down, like you said, Gus?
You did it.
Well, you love crazy people, Gus. You save hurt yourself.
Oh, Lisa, you destroy yourself, my child. It's not right.
Wait a minute. You don't mean...
You are so young, this life, my child.
Right now, I feel like a thousand years old.
Rita.
It was an accident.
You deliberately injected those germs into your veins.
It's an accident. Just
Chris. You fool. Why did you let her do it?
Chris.
Rita, I got it. Oh, darling. Darling, how could you?
Here. Put her on the bunk. I would get the blankets.
I'll come through all right, Chris. I'll be fine. You just keep your arms around me.
All right. Put her down gently now. You have the serum?
Yeah.
All right. Use it quickly.
Stay close. My darling.
Chris, why do you wait?
Suppose it was the serum that killed Pete.
That can't be my Pete. Look at her.
Well, without the serum, she might recover. We don't know.
Give it to her, I say.
Gus, I can't.
You are a coward. You hear me? Coward.
Wait.
No. Give me that hypodermic.
Wait. I'm all right. Rita, for every arrogant second of my life, forgive me. Swab her arm, Gus. I'm ready.
And in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, in 3 months we shall return with the equipment and get the hospital started.
Yeah, yeah.
I am completely unworthy of this great honor you do me. If there is credit due, and undoubtedly there is, it belongs entirely to my wife.
Yeah, it is so.
Boy, hand the microphone to Mrs. Claiborne.
It was a tough fight, Mom, but I won.
Mrs. Claiborne really doesn't feel she deserves the beautiful silver tea set. All she asks is a monument placed side by side by that of Florence Nightingale.
With the simple inscription, to the girl who knocked the spots off Spotted Beaver.
You know, you two in 1 hour, you will be making just such a speech to the Institute dinner.
Oh, he'll be much better before a bigger audience, Gus.
It is a great occasion for us all, Rita.
Gus, you haven't said how you like it up here.
What?
Our personal, private, favorite spot.
Where the lights of the city spread out like a carpet under your front wheels.
Yeah, it is beautiful. I did not know of this place.
No one does. Only those we like a whole lot. Chris, you know what I think?
What, darling?
You were wrong about this not being a good place for laughter. Remember when you said that?
Mrs. Claiborne, I am never wrong. I have never been wrong. You know that.
But I feel much like laughter, darling. Much like smiles. Much like being happy.
Gus, is that a proper attitude from a bride of 3 days?
Yeah, it is fine.
Well, then I was wrong. Go ahead with your laughter, darling. Smile. And if we're lucky, be happy always.
Your tone will be back in just a moment. Pleasant having you back with MGM.
Is this radio program considered back with MGM?
Well, not exactly, but it's an extension of the studios at Culver City.
Well, now, let's say it's pleasant to be back with the MGM extension.
Some of the plays we do here should revive a few memories, Francho. Not that your career goes that far back, but you made some pretty good pictures with us. Do you have any favorites?
Well, there was Mutiny on the Bounty, of course, and I particularly like playing with Gene Harlow in the Blonde Bombshell. There was a picture ahead of its time, Howard.
Well, we'll make up for that by doing the Blonde Bombshell on the radio one of these days.
It'll be good, but I doubt if you'll get anyone who typifies the amusing qualities of the artificial Hollywood Belle the way Miss Harlow did.
I agree. We'll have a problem there. However, getting closer to today, I see where you've made the man on the Eiffel Tower.
Yeah, Howard, but that's distributed by RKO. You don't allow such mentions on your program, do you?
This is not an MGM plugging operation. RKO is a good company, too. And I hope they do well by the man on the Eiffel Tower.
Thank you, Howard.
And thank you, Franco Cone.
You have been listening to His Brother's Wife, starring Franco Cone, adapted for radio by William Kendall Clark. Original music composed and conducted by Joel Herron. The program was directed by Mark B. Loeb and produced by Raymond Katz. The supporting cast included Alice Frost, Everett Sloan, and Mason Adams. Ed Stokes speaking.